I'm Abby Hart with Ecoagriculture Partners and Cornell University, co-author of a new study published in World Development that shares the results of the Landscapes for People, Food, and Nature Initiative's Continental Review of Integrated Landscape Initiatives in Africa. This presentation is a summary of key results and findings. For the full story, follow this link to find our study in World Development. Poverty, food insecurity, and the loss of ecosystem services and biodiversity are serious problems in many African nations. Many actors are working together to address these challenges, but a lack of coordination often forces them to compete for land, water, investment, and other resources. Conservation is often portrayed as incompatible with agriculture and with livelihoods. This mindset often results in single-sector projects that tend to pursue objectives solely in their own domain, often at the expense of others. Integrated Landscape Initiatives, or ILIs, are an alternative to this approach. ILIs are highly participatory programs that are based on the idea that engaging multiple stakeholders in coordinated activities, policies, and investments across a landscape will be more effective in the long term at achieving many objectives at once, in particular those related to human livelihoods and well-being, food production, and biodiversity conservation. We define landscapes as mosaics of natural and human-modified ecosystems characterized by topography, vegetation, land use, and settlements, and influenced by ecological, historical, economic, and cultural processes. Current understanding of integrated landscape approaches is fragmentary, often anecdotal, and spread widely across academic fields. To help fill this gap, we surveyed ILI leaders and participants across sub-Saharan Africa with the aim of answering six key questions. I'd also like to point out a few limitations of the study. There are undoubtedly ILIs in Africa that did not participate in our survey. ILIs with poor internet access may not have responded to the survey, and those without documentation in English, French, or Portuguese may not have been identified by our team. In addition, all results are self-reported by ILI participants without independent verification. Now let's discuss the results. For our first question, we asked, where and in what context are ILIs happening? We identified and surveyed 87 ILIs in 33 of the 48 countries in sub-Saharan Africa. The ILIs work in what we describe as mosaic landscapes. For instance, the average ILI had four different major land cover types, or land uses, and four minor land uses, typically a combination of forest, agriculture, pasture, and small pockets of urban development. Their populations range from several hundred to several million residents. Together, they represent all major biomes in Africa. For our next question, we asked, why are ILIs initiated, and what challenges are motivating their formation in Africa? Almost 80% of initiatives named the need to reduce land degradation, improve sustainable land management, and conserve biodiversity as important challenges that they were seeking to address. Improving health and nutrition and adapting to climate change were the least common responses to this question. The third question we asked was, how are ILIs tackling these challenges, and in what activities are they investing to achieve their objectives? When surveying ILIs about their activities, we asked them to report on activities in four domains: agriculture, conservation, livelihoods, and institutional planning and coordination. 94% of initiatives invested in activities in at least three of the four domains, and 83% invested in all four. On average, ILIs invested in more activities in institutional planning and coordination than any other domain. For example, 62% of ILIs worked to resolve conflict among multiple local stakeholders. In contrast, the livelihoods domain showed the lowest number of investments on average. 1 in 10 ILIs reported no activities in this domain. Next, we asked, who is involved in ILIs? Which sectors and groups of stakeholders play a role in designing and implementing ILIs? Although presence is not a guarantee of true participation, we asked respondents to identify the stakeholders that had contributed in substantive ways to the ILIs. Our findings? ILIs are truly multi-stakeholder initiatives involving on average more than 9 stakeholder groups from 4 different sectors. The most frequently reported participants were local and district government in 86% of ILIs and producer associations in 83%. Private sector stakeholder groups were notably absent from most ILIs, with agribusiness groups found in 8%, logging in 5%, and mining groups in only 3% of ILIs. Although most initiatives have a balanced representation of stakeholders internal and external to the landscape, some ILIs are still driven by top-down processes. This stands in contrast to what we found in a similar study of ILIs in Latin America, where widespread volunteerism and grassroots organization seemed to be more common. Finally, we asked, what outcomes are ILIs achieving, and what have been some of the most and least successful aspects of their experiences? We asked respondents to identify outcomes in the same four domains for which they reported activities. Overall, when comparing investments to outcomes, the number of outcomes was significantly lower. This finding is not necessarily concerning, considering that many of the initiatives are still quite young. As with activities, the institutional planning and coordination domain had the highest number of outcomes. More than three-quarters of initiatives reported increased local capacity for sustainable landscape management, as well as improved coordination and cooperation among stakeholders. Improved access to health resources, restoration of ecosystem services, and expansion of land under agriculture were the least frequently reported outcomes. Early, tangible achievements like putting an area under protected status, establishing a new coordinating body, or improving agricultural yields were often reported by respondents under the most successful aspects of their initiatives. These achievements seem to play an important role in maintaining the momentum of ILIs and leading to future successes. Participants' responses on the least successful aspects of their initiatives revealed some of the main challenges that ILIs face in achieving their goals. Finding sustainable funding sources that could support ILI activities over the long term was frequently mentioned. ILIs are often dependent on short-cycle funding from external sources rather than having access to funding from stable sources within the landscape, such as the government. Respondents often reported that a short time frame for implementing project activities prevented them from moving beyond the initial phase of planning and coordinating stakeholder interests to implementing specific activities. What other conclusions can we draw from this study? Although ILIs are more widespread than in the past, it is not clear that they represent a new paradigm for development in Africa. Our continental review of Latin America found that ILIs were greater in number, had more years of experience, and possessed a greater variety of mechanisms for supporting ILIs than those studied in Africa. Interestingly, many of the objectives and activities that ILIs engage in are not new. What integrated landscape approaches seem to add to conventional models for conservation and development is an intentional effort to use participatory adaptive management and social learning approaches to achieve their objectives. Based on our results, the emphasis on multi-objective, multi-stakeholder participatory models is, in many cases, yielding a broader range of outcomes. Participation by a greater number of stakeholder groups, making investments in capacity building, and establishing or strengthening multi-stakeholder coordinating bodies were all associated with greater numbers of positive outcomes. However, ILIs are not always the best model. ILIs are most useful for long-term development of landscapes to achieve multiple objectives. In many cases, when important objectives require immediate attention, such as short-term relief from a natural disaster or the imminent extinction of a highly valued species, an ILI may not be the right choice. However, integrated landscape approaches may serve as a valuable complement to focused investments that are able to target these short-term needs. Looking ahead, it will be important to develop quantitative assessments of the outcomes of ILIs, particularly as they relate to food production and poverty alleviation, two of the most pressing development goals in Africa. Stay tuned for results from the second phase of our study coming in early 2014. We conducted in-depth interviews with multiple leaders from 12 of the landscapes that participated in the first phase. The results will enrich our preliminary findings on ILIs with details on policies and finance mechanisms, coordinating bodies, and the distribution of benefits across stakeholder groups. I hope that you have enjoyed learning about our work. We would like to thank John Buchanan, Sarah Scher, and Louise Villeman for their input on this project, and most of all, the survey respondents, who are working hard to make positive change in their landscapes across sub-Saharan Africa. This presentation is a contribution of the Landscapes for People, Food, and Nature Initiative, with financial support from TARE Africa and USAID. Thanks for listening.